thank you. We praise you. We give you glory. We stand in this place, God, needing your hand touch, needing you to do more for us, needing you to do those things that we cannot do for ourselves. God, we draw from your strength. We draw from your power, from your anointing on tonight. Fall afresh on us. Give us what we need. Show us how. In the name of Jesus, God, we pray your blessings upon your people, that they be receptive to the word of God, that it go down into their heart, matriculate back up to the brain, putting activities in their limbs that they would carry out, hallelujah, your will for their life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We want to go to the 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. If you don't mind, we'll read a little bit.
Say a word, sir.
Beginning at the 19th verse. Okay. If you have it, you can say amen.
Amen.
Now Saul and they and all the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines. And David rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with the keeper and took and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the trench as the host was going forth to fight and shouted for the battle. For Israel and the Philistines had put the battle in array, army against army. And David left his carriage in the hand of the keeper of the carriage and ran into the army, and came and saluted his brethren. And as he talked with them, behold, there came up the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, out of the armies of the Philistine, and spake according to the same words, and David heard them. And all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him and were sore afraid. And the men of Israel said, have ye seen this man that has come up? Surely to defy Israel is he come up. And it shall be that the man who killeth him, the king, will enrich him with great riches and will give him his daughter and make his father's house free in Israel. And David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? May God add a blessing to the reading and hearers of his most holy word. While you're on your seat, I got a crazy subject, but work with me. I told you I was slow. You wanted the job.
You got the job.
Now do the job. If for any reason I don't get no higher than this, pray for me. But as we look at our text in comparison, practical, pragmatic listening and teaching, we will have to discover that there are a lot of people who want jobs, get the job, but won't do the job. There are many people who don't want the job, but get the job, and yet do the job. Have I got a witness in this place? There are folk who clamor for the job, don't get the job, and fight those that have the job. Y'all ain't said nothing to me. There is a discrepancy in our workmanship when we have a job and won't do the job. We are hurting the ministry. We are hurting the people of God who desperately, listen to me real good, seek strong leadership. It's not that they don't like your suit. It's not that they don't like the color shoes you wear. It's not they don't like the way you comb your hair. It's your inability to get the job done. It's not always that people hop churches because they just want to be the elaborate church hopper. Some people hop churches because they're looking for strong leadership. No, they're not hopping churches because you talked about them. Some people could take you talking about them, but after you talk about them, leave them somewhere. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. After you talk about them, leave them somewhere, and maybe they'll stay. Look at our text, if you will. Amen. The text takes us where there's a battle going on, a fierce battle between the Philistines and the armies of the Lord. God's chosen army. God's hand-picked army. God called them personally himself. He gave them a name when they did not even have a name. He instructed them, qualified them, watch this, took them through boot camp, and then sent them out to fight. And all he required of them, Pastor Chad, was faith. Many a times we don't exercise what we have. This story catches me off guard and it messes with my mind a little bit, because when I look at the text and I evaluate this army has been successful in defeating many armies. Armies larger than themselves. They lost one time to an army smaller than them because they disobeyed God. Could it be we're losing because we disobeyed God? Watch that little quick story at the Battle of Ai, because somebody disobeyed God and touched what they were not supposed to touch. People lost their lives because of disobedience. And they had no business at all touching it when they knew that God will provide for them everything that they need. Many a time we're failing because we don't trust God to give us what we need to make this battle victorious for us. So we get outside the will of God, do what we're not supposed to do, and we go and get will. Somebody say, get will. Some people won't never confess it, will never own up to it, but we'll be whipped all the time. Some of us, you go open our church doors on a Sunday, throw a box of rocks in there and won't hit no. I'm sorry. You won't hit nobody. But we walk around looking victorious when we are losing all the time. This army who's been victorious in many of battles and won in elaborate ways. They won victory after victory. And here they find themselves against the Philistines. They find themselves in a war against the Philistines. One gentleman scares them. I know, perspective. I know, but he was a giant. He was still only one. Some of us are so fickle, frail. Once somebody could say something to us, and we lose all of our hope, we lose all of our faith, we lose everything in us, and we forget about the God who came. This army surprises me. They have all of God at their exposure. The embodiment of who God is at their exposure. The God who spoke the world into existence at their exposure. The God who caused manna to fall from heaven, water to come from a rock is at their exposure. Yeah. The God who hung the sun, sprinkled the stars in the sky like scattered diamonds against the blue velvet. That God who raised the dead. That God who made the lame to walk. That God who made the deaf to talk, the mute to hear. That God at their exposure, and yet they are shaking in their boots. They got the job, but they're afraid to do the job. Watch the text. Teasing with Bishop Tate up here a minute ago, because I know he's a word man. I say, what does the word ineptitude mean? Really mean in his inimitable fashion? The lack of ability to do the job. The inability to get the job done. You have the job. You have the tools, but you won't use it. I'm sorry. We have too many scary folks in Christendom now. We have too many scary folks in Christendom. They just go with whatever the flow is. Too scared to kick against the grain. Your healing may be against the grain. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. Your deliverance may be against the grain. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. Well, let me tell you, Jesus went against the grain to heal some folks, and the folks that were just going with the flow stood up and say, how you gonna do this on the Sabbath day? He did this all the way. He threw it back in their face. Which one of you having an ass would fall into a hole? Won't get him out. In other words, sometimes you have to go against the grain without fear. We like to go with the flow. We like to roll with folks who pat us on the back but don't mean us no good. We like to roll with folk who scared themselves, because if we stay together, we'll look good together. But I don't mind looking bad as long as I'm going somewhere. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm going somewhere. Talk about me if you want to. I'm going somewhere. Watch the text. David's father sends him out to check on his three brothers. He goes to check on his three brothers to check their well-being out. He goes and start hearing this Goliath breathing out threatenings. They hear him. No. You got some folk that like to flinch at you. Y'all don't like the truth. You got some folk that they want to put fear in you with a jump. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. My brother who's gone on to be with the Lord, my brother stood 5'2", nothing at all, but he walked in, he covered every ground he stood on. And he amazed me because he had a lot of folks scared of him. And to be honest with you, I grew up scared of him because I couldn't imagine why a 6'2" guy followed him around like he was somebody bad. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. And one year, my brother bought me a bad go-kart. I had the baddest go-kart in the town. It was a Firebird. It had all the plastic on it back in the 80s when nobody had that. I had the baddest one. But my brother only had one condition, that I could only ride it when he was around. But he messed around and left and stayed gone too long, and that thing was calling my name. So I crunked it up, jumped on it, and was riding it. And you know how it is. There are some young girls out there. I was showing out, doing donuts. I flipped. So I went home, parked it, washed it up, cleaned it up, but I didn't realize it was a scratch on the motor. And anybody that knew my brother, he's meticulous about everything. He gave that thing a comprehensive scrutinizing observation, evaluation, and he looked that thing and seen it had some scars on it. And he had his boys with him, so he started hollering at me in front of his boys. Now, I didn't took enough of that. I was scared of him, but I was more so embarrassed that he was doing it in front of his boys. Y'all ain't saying anything. And then he got so mad, he hollered at me one more time. I did that. He looked like he about to cut a flip. I put fear in him because I flinched. He didn't know my heart was beating so fast. If he had jumped back, I probably would have fainted. All Goliath was doing was flinching. All the army had to do was jump and bite back at him. And some of you are falling because people flinching at you and you too scared. Look at your neighbors, I ain't scared. David heals these threatenings. And then David began to question, who is this? Who is this? Sometimes we give too much credit to who is this. Sometimes you have to take that same spirit Paul had. Paul showed up at the house to minister, and he said, when I went in, it had them dignified folks in there. He said, but whoever they were, I didn't even pay them no mind. They came to spy out my liberty. But what they don't know is greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I don't care if he's 5'2" or 9'2". If God be for you, watch the text. David begins to question what would be given to the one who defeat this fellow. David wasn't really that concerned about the finances or any of that. It was just a general question. And it's proven in the text later down. David maneuvers in his brothers. I didn't really want to stop. But the Lord put me there. This is why I get messy. His brothers, his older brother especially, Eliab, he gets angry, the Bible says, because David is questioning. I think he realized David seen how scared he was. Y'all saying nothing. It hurt his feelings to know his little baby brother was out questioning him and seeing him scared. Watch the text. David's battle with Goliath was nothing compared to his battle with his brothers. His battle with Goliath and the Philistines were nothing compared to the brother, to the fight that he had to have with his own brothers. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. I could see David saying, look, man, that's the enemy, not me. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. It looked like I should understand the fight outside the church. But when I come in here, I gotta fight my brother. When I come in here, I have to fight my sister. I can understand fighting the folk on the job. I can understand fighting the folk at the red light. I can understand fighting Houston traffic. But when I get to the house of God, I still have to fight. Well, y'all gonna help me after a while? His brother got mad. Lord, help me today. Help me preach this day. My brother, Matt, his brother sounds as if he's been agitated with David. This didn't just happen, Lord, help me today. I preached a sermon, all it takes is a situation. His brother obviously had already been agitated by David's anointing. Y'all ain't said nothing to me. There are some folk, if something happened and they jump mad with you, and you like, all I did was say hi. Look like some folk get mad and all you did was show up. They get mad because somebody mentioned your name. This is a sign. This brother had already been mad with David. He's already been agitated with David. David shows up and he gets angry. He asks David, what you doing here? Isn't it how some people look at you sometimes? You just showed up to the meeting because you were invited. Y'all don't want to help me, that's all. All you did was show up because you were invited. Watch this. You showed up to where you was originally supposed to be. Well, let me help y'all out. I love my bishop. He's probably watching me tonight. Bishop Alfonso Dissonant, don't check my record now for at least till September. I'm still coaching because my credentials is paid. Watch me. And I think I'm going to pay them again in September again. But I must say this. There's a particular individual told my bishop, because I'm faithful. If I'm going to be a part of something, I'm going to be a part of it. And I like that because of my previous pastors, Dr. Hines and Charles Stevenson Sr. Charles Stevenson Tivenson told me something that sticks with me today. He said, whenever you be a part of something, make sure they know you're there. It's not always what you say. Sometimes it's just your availability. Let me help somebody right there. You have all the ability in the world, but you're late to everything. You never show up to nothing. Now you mad with somebody who show up that don't have your ability, but always get the assignment. Oh my God. Oh my God. Watch this. I was faithful. I went to the district meetings. I went to the workers' meeting. I went to the state meeting. I was where I was supposed to be. If my bishop was preaching somewhere, I say, I'd drive you if I can. I would be there. And he said, one fella showed up and said, what are Williams doing? He had everything. He must want something. I love this response of my bishop, and I love him today for it. My bishop say, I don't know what he wants, but if he wants something, he's going about it the right way. The truth of the matter is you're just doing what you always do and always have done, and some people can't handle your faithfulness. Watch this. Not only can they handle your faithfulness, but they can't handle you being rewarded for your faithfulness. Some people tell you they want you to be successful until you become successful. I'm almost done. I'm almost done. Watch the text. David just shows up. His brother say, what you doing here? Which sends a signal to me. Like I told you, I'm slow. My bread ain't always done. So I had to dig a little deep. Can I tell you why some folk don't shout in church? Can I tell you why some folk are mean and sad and stuck up and stale, stagnated, not going anywhere? Because they have forgotten their testimony. I had to do a little digging into it, and my mind started thinking, why is brother so mad with David? David always celebrated his victories. Watch this. David, the younger brother, his older brother's part of the armies of the Lord. They got this glistening armor on every day. They got all of the nice badges that give their rank, their service time, their stripes. They look good in their uniform, man. And they won a lot of battles, but they stop celebrating. When you stop celebrating, you forget who the one calls you to celebrate. They stop being happy over their testimony. They lost joy because they stopped remembering how God brought them out. So I can see those brothers getting mad at the dinner table at Jesse's house. David was just a little shepherd boy. It's in the text. Y'all go finish reading the rest. It's in the text. David was just a shepherd boy. So I can imagine every time dinner time came around, the brothers come in their uniforms, sit to the table. They're not happy anymore. They just dreary and down. You know, like some folk in here tonight. They just can't wait to. And here David come in running a little late. He's still dirty. He still got a little bear fur on him. He still got a little lion fur on him. And David come in running to the table excited. Daddy, guess what happened? While I was watching the sheep, y'all ain't said nothing to me. A bear came in and the Spirit of the Lord came on me. The other days another one came and then a lion. Y'all ain't said nothing to me. And the more he told his testimony, the madder the brothers got. I'm trying to help somebody in here today. Keep telling your story if nobody want to listen to it. If he brought you off drugs, keep telling your testimony. If he paid your light bill, keep telling your testimony. If you couldn't fix nothing but sausage and tomato gravy, and now you eating steak, tell your story, y'all. I really wish I could preach this name. My voice just about gone. I preached Saturday, preached three times Sunday last night. Now I'm here. Y'all on the word. But watch the text. I now understand why the brothers in uniform who had the job. Can I tell you something? I'm going to throw this in here and I'm going to be out of here in a minute, I promise you. Some people get the job by default. God knew those who had the job were scary, had no faith, watchmen out, had no anointing, had no Holy Ghost. You just been occupying a position. Messing with me tonight, y'all pulling this out of me tonight. By the lack of your amens, I know it's you. By the lack of your shout, I know it's you. Y'all don't want to say nothing to me. The only way people know that you really wasn't doing the job is because somebody showed up who's doing it without the title. Somebody doing it without the pay. Somebody doing it not for finances. They doing it because the Spirit of the Lord. David, what you doing here? You don't even have on your uniform. Watch the text. I'm serious. I'm almost done. David does what I want to encourage somebody in here today to do. David talked to a few series of people. He wasn't getting the answer he wanted. Y'all missing me. He wasn't getting the answer he wanted. Then he had to fight his own brother, but he ignored him. I'm trying to help somebody. Y'all missing me. I see y'all slow like me. David ignored his brother's attack. He sidestepped his brother. Let me tell you something. Sometimes you're wasting your time fighting with some people. Even if it's your own family member, even if it's your own church member, you waste your precious time fighting with folk that's scary, ain't gonna do nothing. All they're trying to do is stop you from doing something. You need to get it in your mind. They start talking that noise, throw your hand up. They start talking about, I remember when you was a dope head. I remember when you wasn't nothing. I remember you just a little. The implication of the text says, he sidestepped, he ignored everything that they were saying and said, you know what? I'm going to the king. I wish I had a few more folks in here that know what I'm talking about. You gotta ignore some folk down here and go up higher and talk to thee. Watch the text to prove what I'm saying. David wanted the job for all the right reasons because David had proper perspective on the whole situation. David looked at the situation and said, y'all scared because of your own life, but I want to fight him because he's defied the armies of the Lord. In other words, if the armies of the Lord lose this fight against this one giant, what the rest of the world going to think? And if you look on your television today, the world is pointing its finger at the church, making us look like we are nothing because we won't fight the battle that's been given us to fight. We used to sing songs, I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. If I die, let me die. God has made you rich. Everything is palatable and couching for you. You sit in your office, sit behind your desk, wearing your gaiters and all your nice suits, and won't come out the office and fight. Y'all working me tonight. Y'all might have to add some zeros to that check tonight. Watch the text. David sidestepped him. He sidestepped him. He go talk with the king. When you want a job, before you get the job, you have to be interviewed. The king sees David. He said, y'all bring him here. I hear what he's saying out there. Bring him to me. He comes in, sits down. He said, man, you're nothing but a lad. What did I just say? David said, all I have is my testimony. I can't talk about my PhD, my DDD, my MD. I can't tell you too much about my family's last name. All I know, my daddy's name, Jesse. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. I can't tell you about what school. I can't tell you about Morehouse, Spelman. I can't tell you about Bishop College. I can't tell you about nothing. But what I can tell you, while I was tending my father's sheep, I can't tell you all of that. I can't tell you how verbs and subject agree and all of that good stuff. But I can tell you, when that bear came, I took the jawbone of an ass. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. And I whipped him until he ran back in the woods. Y'all don't want to help me in here tonight? And a lion came. Y'all don't want to help me? And a lion came and I beat him down. Oh, King, if you let me, the same thing that happened to the lion and the bear. But wait a minute, King, I got something else to tell you. I don't want to make it seem like it was easy, because I got some good news for you. The lion did get his claws on me. Y'all sit down, but I got to tell this one. The lion put his claws on me. I'm not going to pretend like I just whipped him without him getting a hold to him. But to make the testimony more positive, y'all messing with me in here. He had to tell nothing but the truth and the whole truth to make it more profitable for his resume. In other words, you have to tell the whole truth. If you went broke, tell the truth. You went broke. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. If you slipped and fell, tell the truth. You slipped and fell. If you and the devil had a tussle, tell the truth. He did get a good lick in. Tell the truth. He did almost knock me out. The reason David was able to tell the truth, because he told the conjunction that changed the story around, and he said, "Bullet." Testimony is not a good testimony if you can't say, but I was sick, but the Lord healed me. I was knocked out, but the Lord picked me up. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. I was out in my sin, but the Lord, can I go old school, pick me up, turn me around, place my feet on solid ground. And when David finished, the king said, "Come on, boy, come in the closet. Let me put some armor on you, Bishop." And Bishop Porter, in his absence, I pray to God that we don't make the same mistake. Stop trying to put things on folks that you won't use yourself. You got a whole army of them with the glistening uniform, but they won't even fight. Stop trying to tell me to do it like you, because the truth be told, you still ain't done nothing yet. You've been with the job a long time, and now that you done got fired, and God has given it to me, you want to show up in my office and tell me to be like you? The devil is a liar. Somebody say, the devil is a liar. Say, I don't know about that uniform. I've never tried it yet. But I know the Lord will make a way. The Lord will come in and fight my battles. Have I got a witness here? Can you touch your neighbor? Say, neighbor, I got the job. I wanted the job. And I'm going to do the job with the help of the Lord. Come what will it be, I'm going to stand. Come what will it be, I'm going to fight. Come what will it be, I'm going to shout. Come what will it be, I'm going to praise. Somebody up in here today, the Lord has helped you get the job done. And I dare you, I double dog dare you, to let the devil know, I still have my joy. When you work your testimony, he'll give you another one, and another one, and another one. If you want to make your enemy mad, if you want to make your hater mad, get the job, do the job, and then praise God for it, and let him know, this giant I'm facing is nothing to me. I'ma praise, I'm gonna dance in the face of the enemy. Have I got a witness here? David picked up those stones, and I like to believe in my mind, he put them in his bag and skipped toward the giant. When you have faith, you will shout on your way to battle, because you know you're gonna shout your way out.
up in this house. David exercised faith, and I'd like to believe why he was skipping. He said, victory shall be mine if I hold. Let the Lord fight my old victory shall be mine. He took him out. He took him out. He took him out. Y'all don't want to praise with me. On his way out, I believe he starts skipping again. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Shout yeah, shout yeah, yeah. I know he's all right. I quit. But I wonder if there's any praises in the house. I wonder if there are real praises in the house. I say, I wonder if there are real praises in the house. Watch me real good. Put it in your heart. Put it in your mind. I say, put it in your heart. Put it in your mind. Go back to the last victory you had. I mean a real victory. I ain't talking about that manufactured, made up stuff that you do politely at testimony side, giving out into card. Yo, I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about the one that had tears lapping under your cheeks. Snot coming out your nose. Because you are overjoyed with that victory. Think about that victory. And I double dog dare you to praise him for that victory. Wait a minute. Let me help you here. Y'all know what an encore means, right? When somebody do something real good, you begin to praise them. You begin to worship the performance. And you do it and do it. And that's what they call an encore. And what an encore simply means is, Lord, do it again. Somebody say, Lord, you got to show him that you want him to do it again. Put that testimony in your mind. And on the count of three, I want you to praise him like he just done it. If it was 10 years ago, act like he just done it. If it was 2 weeks ago, praise him again. One, two. For what he's already done. But if you got the spirit of David, this one is for what you know you want him to do. Put the thing in your mind that you want him to do. Get it in your heart and in your mind real good. You got to almost taste that thing. You got to have visual perspective and say, I'm driving that thing. I'm standing behind that new pulpit. Walking in that new office. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I'm driving up on new concrete. We got an expansion. You got to see that thing. I see my son coming off drugs. I see my daughter coming back in. I see my house being back together. I see spirits being broken. If you get